Welcome to this presentation on psychrometric problems. Looking at what we've done last time, we started with the principles of psychrometrics, and we'll actually continue with some principles here, but we'll start applying those and working some extra problems in this presentation. All right, the first thing I want to talk about is the dew point. So we're familiar with the dew point. You've heard this on the news when we hear about weather reports. And what we're going to look at here is where this shows up in our psychrometrics. Stuff that we're interested in. So here we are at some initial temperature. So if we have some moist air, it's at some temperature, there will be some partial pressure of vapor in that air. And that partial pressure, as long as we're not seeing it, if we can see through the air, it's all vapor, it's superheated, right? The partial pressure of the vapor indicates that vapor is superheated. Now, once we start to cool that air, right, it'll maintain its partial pressure vapor. The quantity, the amount of vapor in that air will not change if we cool that air. So it'll stay on this constant pressure line, and it'll move toward our vapor dome to a point where we reach point D here, and that is the dew point. That is the temperature. So if we start off at this initial temperature, and we cool down to our dew point temperature, we'll eventually hit the vapor dome. And once we hit the vapor dome at point D, we can't hold any more moisture in the air. Moisture has to condense. It is saturated air. That's why we're at this point on this side of the vapor dome, is the saturated vapor. So what happens to the air? Well, some of it condenses. So some of it basically traverses this side of the vapor dome and it condenses. And we are continually able to cool. So now our partial pressure of the vapor, the amount of vapor we have in the air, decreases. It continues to decrease until we hit the final temperature. So we'll have some final partial pressure, right? Which in this case is the saturated pressure value at this particular temperature. It's going to be less than our initial partial pressure, which is up here. And so we're going to have some vapor at that temperature, and we'll have some condensate at that temperature. And so what we can do is see that over here in this particular case, so we have this weight on top in this piston cylinder setup. This weight maintains a constant pressure on our vapor here. So this is our initial state. And so if this is cooled, that pressure remains constant on the top. It's still the same amount of weight, right? But as it cools, we eventually get some condensate that sits at the bottom, and we have some amount of vapor less than the amount of vapor that we had prior to our process, right, from the initial state. Total mass is the same in this closed system, but the amount that's actually in the vapor phase has been reduced. All right, so in this first example, we're going to take this information we just learned about the dew point and apply it. So just reading through here, on entering a dwelling, maintain at 20 degrees C from the outdoors, where the temperature is 10 degrees C, a person's eyeglasses are observed not to become fogged. So the idea here is that their eyeglasses are at the same temperature as the outdoors, so they come in at 10 degrees C. A humidity gauge indicates that the relative humidity in the dwelling is 55%. Can this reading be correct? Provide supporting calculations. All right, so just drawing up our vapor dome here. So we got a little vapor dome, and we got, we'll do a pressure line here and a pressure line here. So say we're at this temperature here. So here's our temperature and versus our specific volume. All right, and this is the temperature of the dwelling. So it's at 20 degrees. And this is a constant pressure line that goes all the way through here. So we don't know what pressure that's at. But the other thing we need, the key thing here is that if we keep following this over, it's going to hit this pressure line, and this is the partial pressure of the vapor within the dwelling, right? So what's the partial pressure of the vapor within what we walked into in our house? And we need to figure out, does this go below, or does this stay above 10 degrees? So which one of these is 10 degrees? We don't know, right? So question mark there. All right, so we don't know. And so it basically, because if it's below, so if 10 degrees comes across like this, we come down, right, and we hit
Now, we're not going to fog up. But if we come down and 10 degrees is down here, right, we hit the vapor dome, and then we come down to where the 20 degrees is, we have to release some of our moisture in the form of condensation to make it down to this point. So we need to figure out if the 10 degrees is above or below. And this 55%, what we can do is use that and a saturated pressure here to get some information here. So let's look at this. So we're saying that the relative humidity is 55%. And one of the definitions for that is the partial pressure of the vapor divided by the pressure of saturation at a saturation point, which is this, it's at the same temperature, it's at 20 degrees, but it's when it hits the vapor dome. So if we follow the constant temperature line over to the saturated vapor part of the dome, that's our this pressure here. And again, that's all at the mixture temperature and pressure. So that's why we're looking at this at 20 degrees. Okay, so we're given the 55%. We're given, we can find the saturation pressure. So we can calculate what the partial pressure of the vapor is. So that's our 55%. And we got the, if we go look up, the saturation pressure is 0.02339 bar. All right, so we're going to look at the table at 20 degrees C. We can look that up. And the partial pressure of the vapor then is equal to 0.0129 bar. So that's this line, right? I'll change colors here. That's this line right here. All right, that's the 0.0129 bar pressure contour. So now the question is, what is the pressure that we would have at our 10 degrees right here? What's that pressure? Well, we just go back to our vapor tables and we look up the saturation pressure at 10 degrees. And we'll see that's equal to 0.01228 bar. All right, so if that's 1228 bar, oh, that looks like it's just lower. So it's going to be in here. I'm going to draw it. So we got this guy right there. So what that means is we're going to have our, this is where when we walk into the house, air in the house is going to come near the glasses and it's going to start to cool. It's going to cool. And then it's going to keep cooling until it reaches this pressure line, that temperature rather. Right. And so that means because we hit the vapor dome, the only way we can get down here, right, is we have to drop our pressure. And the only way we can do that is to condensate some moisture out of the air to get down to that point. So we will have condensation. So no, this reading is not correct. Is not. All right. Because it's saying 55%, and at 55%, we have this pressure, this partial pressure, and at 10 degrees, we should have condensation. All right, so that's how we can check.
So now we're going to look at a unique way for looking at enthalpy and internal energy when we're dealing with moist air. So from previous mixture evaluation equations, we have this. So if we look at the total enthalpy that we have for our moist air, we would take the enthalpy component from the air and we would add the enthalpy component for the vapor. And because we're breaking this out into the amount of air and vapor, we need to break it out into the mass of the air, because typically we have the enthalpy values on a kilojoule per kilogram basis. So we need the mass to tell us how many kilograms we have of that. So the mass of the air times the enthalpy of the air plus the mass of the vapor times the enthalpy of the vapor. All right, so we've seen this before. This is nothing unfamiliar. But one of the things that's very useful for us to use is to get the mixture enthalpy per unit mass of dry air. All right, so this is what we have is the mixture enthalpy is at this same H value from up here, and it's divided by the mass of the dry air. So we take that whole equation that we have up above. We're going to divide this whole equation by the mass of the dry air right here. And if we do that, we end up with just the enthalpy of air plus the mass of the vapor divided by the mass of the air times the enthalpy of the vapor. Now, if you remember this term from earlier, as pointed out here, this is our humidity ratio. This is omega. All right? And we have a way to calculate omega, which I'll show next here. But I also want to highlight here, useful. Why is this value useful? Because the mass of air shouldn't change for a given flow. Right? Think about that. If we have a moisture that's traveling through some duct, and let's say the duct is very cool, and so same thing with the dew point. We cool below the dew point, things start condensing. But the amount of air that condenses, dry air, none of the dry air condenses. The dry air continues along. It's the vapor that condenses. So the mass of the air remains constant through the processes that we'll be looking at. All right. So why is using omega useful? Because we have this equation, and we can usually find this partial pressure of the vapor without too much difficulty. And this is the pressure of the entire mixture, which we usually have information on. All right. So we'll look at this in the example. The other thing I want to highlight here is that when we look up these values, and I kind of hit on this last time, but when we're looking up enthalpy values, the enthalpy of the air is going to be found on table A22. All right, and so we're just using gas. We can use the ideal gas tables. Sometimes, maybe if we're using specific constant specific heat, we can use those as well. But typically, we'll be on table A22. With the vapor, though, I want you to be careful because in table A23, there is water vapor in table A23. Now, the problem is there, it has a different starting point, different datum from which its values go to zero. Its enthalpy values go to zero. And it's not the same as what they have in tables A2 and A3, A4, right? The tables that we use there. So we're using the steam tables when we're looking at the vapor, not the ideal gas tables, right? So just note that difference there. The other thing I want to look at here is the Mollier diagram. And what we can see here is it gives us information about how to calculate our enthalpy of the vapor here. And you can see already it's partially, approximately equal to the saturated enthalpy value at a given temperature. So why is that? Well, the Mollier diagram plots the enthalpy versus the entropy, right? Enthalpy versus entropy. But the thing we want to see here is for increasing temperature, we go up. Increasing pressure, we go to left. So here's the constant pressure curves. So this is a greater pressure and lower pressure. But look what's interesting. When we get to the superheated realm here, this kind of the blue shaded region, what is the temperature? All right, not only these are constant temperature bars, isothermal bars, right, but they're also constant for a given enthalpy. Right? So once we're in the superheated realm, superheated region, we can grab this approximation, the fact that, hey, if I have some enthalpy value out here, if the enthalpy of my vapor, I'm somewhere out here, it's actually equal to the enthalpy at saturation at that same temperature. All right, so from a Mollier diagram, we can do this approximation, which we'll be doing in our example as well.